हेलो व्यूअर्स, वेलकम टू टुडेज सेक्शन। माय सेल्फ रश्मिता जेना, लेक्चर इन कंप्यूटर साइंस, यूएन कॉलेज ऑफ साइंस एंड टेक्नोलॉजी, अरसपुर। सो टुडे आई एम गोइंग टू डिस्कस द कंकरेंसी कंट्रोल टेक्निक्स। एज यू नो दैट इन मल्टी प्रोग्रामिंग सिस्टम द नंबर ऑफ ट्रांजेक्शंस आर एग्जीक्यूटेड साइमल्टेनियसली, एंड इन दैट केसेस देर मे बी चांसेस ऑफ फेल्योर ऑफ सम ट्रांजेक्शन। So in that case, when the transaction are executed concurrently, then we must apply some technique to control this concurrency executions. So today we will discuss the concurrency control, what are the different concurrency control techniques. So today we will discuss the database concurrency control. So first we will discuss the purpose of concurrency control, or why we need concurrency control techniques. Then the locking technique, which is used to control the concurrency execution of transaction. So first we will discuss the what is database concurrency control. Actually, in multiprogramming system, the number of transactions are executed simultaneously. So in that time, there may be a chances of interference of other transactions, or there may be a chances of failure of one transaction, or there may be a chances of one transaction may be, if for a long period of time, it may be in deadlock situation. So to overcome these problems during multiprogramming system, we are using some concurrency technique. And also there may be some situation where the isolation property of the transaction may be violated. So due to this reason, the transaction may need the concurrency control technique. So the different purpose of concurrency control means, in multiprogramming environment, as I already told about that, where multiple transaction can be executed simultaneously. We know that in multiprogramming, more than one transactions are executed at the same time, and it is highly important we have to control the concurrency of the transaction, and also to enforce the non-interference or isolation among the conflicting transaction. To enforce the non-interference means, that means we must ensure that one transaction must not interference with the another transaction while that transaction is executed. Then third point, to preserve the database consistency through the consistency preserving execution of transaction. That means when we are executing one transaction, that transaction may be changed from one state to another state, one state to another state, and in that time transaction must maintain the consistency through the consistency preserving execution of the transaction. And the last point, the purpose of the concurrency control, to resolve the read write and write write conflict between the transaction. This is the one example of concurrent execution of transaction. That means we have suppose two transaction, that is T1 and T2. If T1 conflict with T2 over a data item A, that means we have one data item, that is A, and both T1 and T2 are want to access the data item A. So in that time there may be a conflict between T1 and T2. Then in that situation, the existing concurrency control, that means the existing concurrency control technique, decide if T1 or T2 should get A and if the other transaction is rollback or wait. So this is the example of concurrency execution environment of two transaction. Then we will discuss how we can improve the concurrency control between the two transaction using technique, that is locking technique. So locking means what? That is a method or mechanism through which one transaction may lock a data item, and the transaction will hold that data item until it finishes its execution. That means during one transaction hold a particular data item, that data item cannot access by the other transaction. So in this way we may overcome the conflict between the two transaction. So let's see what is locking and how we can lock the data item. Locking means, or lock means, a variable that associated with the data item that describes the status of the item with respect to possible operation that can be applied to it. So lock means it is a variable. This variable is associated with the data item. Those data items are used in our transaction, and that locking or that lock variable describes the status of the item. The status of the item means that means that item can used by the transaction or not. That means that data item is locked by some transaction or still it unlock. That will be described the status of the item with respect to some possible operation that can be applied. If it is locked by some transaction, then that data item can be used by that particular transaction which locked the data item. But if it is unlocked, that can be locked by some other transaction. Then comes to second point. There is one lock for each data item in the database. That means if we have one data item, suppose that is X, that can perform one lock. There is one lock for each data item in database. Means in a database, if we have one data item, suppose data item is X, and that data item can perform only one lock. That means the data item can perform the data item can be locked by one transaction simultaneously. That means if it is locked by one transaction and it cannot be locked by another transaction until it is unlocked by the transaction which locked the data item. Then comes to third point. Locks are used as a mean of synchronizing the access by the concurrent transaction to the database item. Then comes to what is locking? Locking is an operation which secure the permission to read, permission to write a data item for a transaction. Come to this point, there is one lock for each data item in the database. That means when we are lock a item, it means the item is locked by the transaction and the locking operation grant the transaction for the secure accessing of read operation or securely accessing the write item of that data item. Okay, that is the locking operation. For example, suppose we have the data item X and we perform the locking operation over the data item X, and it can be written as lock X. That means the data item X is locked in behalf of the requiring transaction. That means those transaction is the need to lock the data item, or those transaction is need to do some read write operation over this data item X, then that transaction first must lock that item by performing this operation locking. Lock X, that means this was locked by some transaction, those transaction required to access this data item. Then comes to similarly, when we lock a data item, then after using that data item or after used by that data item by that transaction must be unlock that item. Because if that data item is not unlocking that, then that cannot be used by other transaction or that cannot be locked by other transaction. And for that, the transaction may perform unlocking operation. So unlocking is an operation which removes this permission from the data item. That means this remove the read write permission from the data item. So for example, here you can see here the data item X is locked by some transaction. Those transactions required to access this data item, and this can be unlocked by writing this, that is unlock X. That means the data item X is made available to other transaction that I already explained you. So lock and unlock are the atomic operations. Okay, as we know, atomic is one of the property. Atomicity is one property of the transaction. So this is the lock and unlock are the atomic operation of the transaction. So this is all about lock a variable and unlock a variable by the transaction. What are the different concurrency techniques are used to maintain the concurrency control? There are two types of locking mechanisms are there. One is your binary locking and second one is your two-phase locking, or you can say that is a share and exclusive locking. So first we will know what is binary lock? In binary locking, a lock have two state, that is 0 or 1, or lock, you can say lock or unlock. That means if the lock variable is set as 0, that means the variable is unlocked. The variable is now unlocked, and that can be availed by any transaction those are required to access the particular data item. Okay. But if that variable is set as 1, that means that was locked by some transaction, and when it's set as 1, then it can be only used by that transaction, and other transaction must wait until that variable or that data item is unlocked. Okay, let's see what is binary locking technique. So binary locking technique means, as I already told about that, binary lock can have two state or value, that is 1 and 0. That means if the data item set as 1, that means that is locked by some transaction. If it is set 0, that means it unlocked. That means one transaction is required, that data item can be locked that data item. So let's say the algorithm. A distinct lock is associated with each data item X. That means we have the data item X, and we will perform binary locking technique on this data item X. So if the lock X equals to 0, that means the item is now unlocked. That means the transaction which want to execute or which want to access this data item to read operation or for write operation, that item can lock this item, and after locking this item, that transaction can access this item. So if lock X equals to 0, the item is unlocked, the transaction first lock that item by executing this statement, that is lock X equals to 1. Else means if this condition is true, as we already know the if else conditions in our C programming. So if lock X equals to 0, if this condition is true, that means the item is unlocked. So we can execute this statement, that is then lock X equals to 1, the transaction must lock that item for further use. Otherwise, if lock X equals to 0 is false, false means lock X equals to 1. Okay, that means if this condition is false, then we will go for else part of the if, that means to jump to this part. Else begin, wait until lock X equals to 0. That means that transaction must wait until the lock X equals to 0. That means the item is wait until the item is unlocked. Okay. And when the item is unlocked, the lock manager wake up the transaction. Wake up the transaction means those transactions are wait for accessing the item X. The lock manager will wake up one of the transaction and assign the variable X or data item X to that transaction. Okay, then the transaction first lock the data item, then can execute the data item. So after executing this, we will execute go to B. Go to B means from this to we have to go this location. So first we will check the item is unlocked or not. If lock X equals to 0, that means it is still unlocked, and the transaction will lock by executing this statement, because this condition is true, lock X equals to 0, then lock X equals to 1. It means the transaction which is wait for the data item X first lock that, and from this it will exit to the end part. Okay, so this is about binary locking technique. First it will check lock X equals to, if true, then it will lock the item, and from this it will exit to end. Otherwise, it will go for the else part and execute the else part and go for the end statement. Okay. So next we will see how we can unlock the data item. The following code are performed for unlock operation. That means if lock X equals to 0, it means the item X is unlocked now. If any transaction are waiting, then wake up one of the waiting transaction and assign that data variable X to that transaction. So this is the algorithm to lock the item, this one, and this one is the algorithm for unlock the item, this. Okay, so this is all about your binary locking technique. We have seen that in binary locking technique, one transaction must check first the data item is unlocked or locked. That means if that data item is unlocked, then the transaction must first lock the data item, then can the transaction use that data item. If the transaction is not unlocked, that means the data item is locked by some other transaction. So in that case, the transaction which is requesting for the data item, that transaction must wait until the data item is unlocked. So this is all about your binary locking technique for executing the transaction simultaneously or for controlling concurrency execution of the transaction. So next you will know what are the rules are used for binary locking technique. These are the some rules every transaction must obey for executing the binary locking schema or for using the binary locking schema. So first rule is a transaction T must issue operation lock item X before any read item or write item X operation are performed in T. As I already explained you in binary locking technique, it means this point means if we have a transaction T and transaction T want to execute the read operation and write operation on the data item X. In that case, the transaction must issue lock over that data item first. Then only the transaction can perform the read item operation or write item operation over that data item. This is the first rule of binary locking technique. Transaction T must issue lock item X before executing any read or write operation performed by the transaction T. Then comes to second rule. Second rule is a transaction T must issue operation unlock item X after all read item X and write item X operation are complete in T. It means when the transaction executing all its operations, that means read item on X and write item X, that transaction must perform a unlock operation over that data item X. Because those transactions are wait for that data item, if T will not issue a unlock X, then that transactions cannot lock that item. So this is the second rule. The transaction T must execute unlock X after executing it read item X and write item X. So other transaction can avail that data item X. This is the second rule. Then third rule. The third rule is a transaction T will not issue lock item X operation if it is already hold lock on item X. It means suppose any other transaction lock the transaction X before the transaction T requesting the data item X. In that case, the transaction T must wait until that item is unlocked. Okay, that means when that item is locked, that cannot be locked by transaction T. The transaction T must wait until it unlocked. That is the third rule of the binary locking technique. Then comes to fourth rule. The fourth rule is a transaction T will not issue an unlock item X operation unless it already hold a lock item X. So next we will know what are the disadvantages arises in the binary locking system. In binary locking system, it is too restrictive for database item. Because you just see the rules, that means that is locked by one transaction, then that can be used by only that transaction which locked the item. That cannot be used by other transaction. So this type of restrictive rules are apply over the database item in the binary locking system. That means we can say at most one transaction can hold a lock on a given item. That means if one transaction is issue one lock on that item, then that cannot be used by or that cannot be locked by other transaction. Thus, no two transaction can access the item concurrently. So the problem is what? As it is locked by one transaction, then it cannot be locked by other transaction. So that item cannot access concurrently by the two transaction at the same time. So this is the disadvantages of the binary locking system. So in binary locking system cannot be used for practical purpose. So in the disadvantages are arises in the binary locking system. That means the data item is locked by one transaction that cannot be locked by another transaction, can be overcome in the shared and exclusive locking technique. So in that technique, if that data item is locked by one transaction, then that can be used by or that can be locked by another transaction. So this is overcome in the two-phase locking technique, and we will be discuss briefly the two-phase locking technique in our next session. Thank you. Have a nice day.
Thank you.